Hello, everyone. My name is Pastor Alice. I am reporting live tonight from the Calvary Baptist Announcements Awards. Tonight, we have several celebrities. They are receiving awards for the announcements they are giving. And we are so excited. We have the exclusive coverage to interview them tonight. First up, Paula Deen. Paula Deen is here to accept her award for her announcement. Paula, how you doing? Hey, y'all. Paula Deen here. My award-winning announcement tonight is about Lenten devotionals for Calvary Baptist Church. This year, Calvary's Lenten theme is learning to live in the desert. All right now, these Lenten devotionals do not have to be something written per se. They can be something written or a filmed spoken word, maybe poetry or a short story that you write, or a photograph that you take, or a painting that you've done, any other creative expression that you have, all right? Now, you might be wondering, well, what am I supposed to be writing or creating about, okay? Now, we have five Lenten themes that you are invited to reflect upon how maybe you have experienced these spiritually, okay? All right, we have oasis or relief. We have cactus or our reserves. We have wildlife or our resources in the desert. We have the elements and climate or our resilience, all right? And we have the horizon or our hope, okay? So you are invited to submit a Lenten devotional of some kind. Remember, any kind of creative expression is accepted about how you have maybe experienced spiritually any one of these themes, all right? These are due to Pastor Morgan by February 14th. That is Valentine's Day. I'm making shortbread cookies for my husband. Thank you for this award. What an exciting evening this is, all of these celebrity guests. Yes, next up we have Wolf Blitzer accepting his award for his announcement. Wolf, how are you doing?
Ah, yes, hello, hello, I am Wolf Blitzer. My breaking news, award-winning announcement is about the midweek gathering, yes. This will be on Tuesday, February 2nd. This is a part two from last week's discussion about Amanda Gorman's poem from the inauguration, The Hill We Climb. Last week, participants had so much fun discussing that we ran out of time and requested that they have another session to discuss the many facets of this poem. So if you'd like to join them, that is Tuesday, February 2nd, 6:30 p.m. on Zoom. They will email out that link that day. Thank you so much for my award.
Wow, what an amazing man. We are so lucky to have him here tonight with us. Oh my gosh. Our next guest is the famous Calvary Unicorn. Guys, this is a big deal. Calvary Unicorn, what's up tonight?
Hey, Pastor Alice, I'm doing pretty well. I have two awards tonight for two announcements. First up, in case you missed Calvary's annual meeting this past Wednesday, you have nothing to worry about because we have all the documents that were shown and all the video clips that were shown in the e-news with easy peasy links. So you can view all of that at your leisure in case you missed the meeting or in case you want to watch them again. Also, I'm here to encourage everyone at Calvary to invite a friend to church. You can just send them the link to this service in a text or an email and just say that you think they'd really enjoy it. It's an easy way to get more people to know about Calvary Baptist Church.
Wow, what an amazing Calvary icon. Guys, we are so lucky to be interviewing all of these celebrities tonight and their fabulous announcements about our church. Next up, For our next award and announcement, we have the funny, the amazing, the weird, Jim Carrey. Jim, how do you feel about your announcement award tonight?
Thank you for this award, Pastor Alice. That's going to fit on my shelf like a glove. Okay, all right. Serious, Jim? Serious. The announcement that I am getting my award for tonight is about Ash Wednesday. It's coming up quicker than you think. February 17th. We have that day, ashes to go. An imposition of ashes in the parking lot. Now you might be wondering, is that safe? We are taking every safety measure necessary. And you may get an imposition of ashes on your forehead, on your hand, or a spoken blessing. These ashes will be given at 11:30 a.m. through 1 p.m. and 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Also, in the evening, we will have our Ash Wednesday service, 6:30 p.m. on Zoom. An RSVP is not required. All right. Thank you for my award, Pastor Alice. Now it's time for me to skedaddle.
What a hilarious guy. Oh my gosh, he so deserves his award. Next up, I believe we have, coming all the way from England to receive his announcement award, Colin Firth. Colin, how do you feel about your award?
Yes, thank you, Pastor Alice, for this award. I am truly, deeply honored. My award-winning announcement is Prayers of the People. These are prayer requests that you submit to cbc@calvarydenver.org. They will be read aloud by a pastor. I believe Calvary is doing this once a month. For this month, they are due February 22nd to be read aloud in the February 28th service. And if you just need a particular person or situation lifted up to the Lord, you may submit those to that email address. Now, Bridget Jones, if you're out there, you are perfect just the way that you are. And thank you for this award.
Wow, what an amazing slate of interviews by celebrities. They all deserve those awards for those announcements, and I hope you heard every word. Well, thank you, Calvary Baptist Church, for hosting this awards ceremony. I hope that you have a wonderful worship service. I hope you feel the presence of God with you, the presence of your Calvary community with you, wherever you are worshiping. You are loved, and we miss you. Now let us worship God together.
Please join us in the call to worship.
A love that never ceases.
A creativity that designed the universe.
A hope that cannot be quenched.
A pursuit of reconciliation no matter the cost.
These are the things that are of God. We come to you, O God, to thank you for what is good.
We come to you, O God, to cry out for what is wrong.
We come to you, O God, to ask for help and restoration.
We come to you, O God, with aching hearts and glad souls.
Let us worship God.
seed that God is sowing. You are the life that starts us growing. Spirit, now live in me. Oh, holy rain of God now falling, you make the word of God enthralling. You are that inner voice now calling, Spirit, now live in me.
Good morning. It's time for the Word for God's Children. If the children aren't in the room, please invite them in. In today's Bible story, Luke 6, 1 through 16, there is a lot going on. It's about the Sabbath, a day of rest, and there are a couple of situations where Jesus is trying to explain to the scribes and the Pharisees, religious leaders who knew the law really well, that he, Jesus, is the Lord of the Sabbath, and that doing what is good, like feeding the hungry and healing others, matters. But there are still questions and some conflict over this. Well, there's one verse in this story that really stands out to me, and it's what I'm going to focus on with you today. In the midst of all kinds of chaos, conflict, problems and trouble, and people questioning one way and important things to do, in verse 12, it says, "Now during those days he went out to the mountain to pray, and he spent the night in prayer to God." That was Jesus. Jesus remembered to pray in the midst of it all. I can imagine you have pretty full days too. You maybe have school and chores. You have different activities going on. You might have some choices and important decisions to make. You have a lot to remember. So what are some ways that you remember to do things so you don't forget? Sometimes it might be our parents who help you remember when they say, "It's time for bed," or "Time to go to virtual school," or "Time to clean your room." Some people will use a string on their fingers and look at it later and say, "Now why did I put that on my finger? Oh yeah, I remember what I need to do." Or they might use a rubber band on their wrist or use a reminder app in their phone. My reminder app, it has a long list of reminders. Or some people might use a planner to write down the things they want to remember. And you know what? We can use all of these methods to remember to pray too. So even though that one verse about Jesus praying is a verse in between all of the other verses where there's a lot of other stuff going on, I think that one verse about Jesus taking time away and time to pray has a lot of power and meaning. And it helps me, and I hope it helps you too, to know that even when there is a lot going on, Jesus wants us to take the time to pray, and that will always lead us in the right direction. Let's pray together now. Dear God, remind us that it is okay and it is good to take some time to pray and simply be with you. Help us create habits to remember to pray, even in the middle of conflict and crazy schedules. Thank you for Jesus' example of doing what is good, no matter what day it is, while also honoring space for rest and for prayer. Amen.
As we pray this morning, I invite you to breathe deeply in and out, and to soften your gaze or close your eyes. Lord, as we breathe in and out, may our prayers rise up to meet you this day, as you rise up again and again to meet us. Our prayer today is for sight, O God, for you to raise our gaze so that we have eyes to see what you would have us see. So many times, O God, we admit that when we think of a vision of your kingdom, we see the world only as we have been taught to see it, or only from the lens of our own experience. And yet your vision, O God, Your vision, we know, is held in the eyes of every single person you have created. And if we're not seeing what they see or how they see things too, then open our eyes, O God. Open our eyes to see a more expansive vision of your world. God, we know that not everything that we see will be right or good, that not everything we see will be of your world of justice or peace, that not everything we see will be something we agree with or something that affirms our worldview. We know that not all we see will make sense to us or be comfortable, that it might actually be quite painful and heartbreaking and cause us to question ourselves even or our faith, but we need to see, O Lord. Show us what you need us to see so that we can be prepared for the vision that you want to show us of what could be. First, God, we pray for eyes to see ourselves as you see us. We take a moment to think of something that we see in the mirror that we do not like about ourselves, or one thing that we don't like to see about ourselves that's related to our attitude or our thoughts or our habits, our physical body. Lord, we hold that before you now, gently and honestly and vulnerably. Reshape our vision, O God, so that we can see ourselves and love ourselves as you see us and love us. Lord, we pray for eyes to see the needs of those closest to us, those who live under our same roof, or who we call and connect with regularly, our friends and our family. God, reveal to us what things we overlook because we know that, you know, those folks who we love so deeply, we know that they'll forgive us. We know that they'll always be there. We know that they'll understand if we don't have time for them. But Lord, what is hidden in plain sight before us that we are missing? Show us how we can love those that we love even more deeply, and even in ways that help them live into their truest selves. Sharpen our vision. Likewise, O God, we pray for eyes to see the hurts and longings of those in our own church. While we're apart during this time, we know that we're missing so much. Show us, God, when we're making assumptions about how people are doing, simply because we cannot truly see how they are. Give us new and creative ways of seeing one another during this time. Instead of just thinking out of sight, out of mind, help us call to mind those who need to be seen, who are hurting, those who feel unheard, those who might be withdrawing. Even, O God, help us to see those who we might see on Zoom all the time, but maybe we have not connected more deeply with them. Draw our gaze to our own siblings in Christ who might need us more than we think. Place their names on our heart now so that we can reach out to them this week. And God, we really don't want to pray for this, but we're going to anyway because we know we need to. We pray for eyes to see, O Lord, those whom we disagree with in our society, in our country, in our culture. We call to mind now the name and the face of anyone who we might consider an enemy, someone who we just can't understand their perspective or beliefs, someone who we actually call names or we disparage or degrade. It might be one person, O God. It might be a group of people. But Lord, bring them into our mind's eye right now. Help us to see their humanity, their worth, their dignity, their desires, their longings, their own brokenness. And when we just can't see it, God, hold our gaze there longer to keep looking and to keep searching. And God, if it's harmful for us to envision these people, then give us grace so that we can step away. But draw us back again when we are ready to see all of your children as just that, your children. Forgive us for the ways that we dehumanize others in word and in action, and grant us the kind of sight that won't allow us to see anyone as less than, no matter their sins or shortcomings. God, we know that we'll never stop seeing past one another until we truly see each other. Forgive us for how many times we have to ask for forgiveness about this, for how many times we fail to see. Remind us that this is at the heart of our call as a gospel people. Lord, we pray for those who are suffering this day, those who are oppressed. There are so many who are suffering and who are struggling because of things that are out of our control and also because of the things that are in our control, O God, systems that we've created. And so this morning, we just think of one group of people or one person who we have seen suffering this week or who we have noticed is being oppressed. It might be a story we heard on the news. It might be an interaction we had. But we imagine this one person or this group of people now, O God. And again, help our sight to fall first on their humanity and their dignity and their worth, not to have pity for them because of their suffering or their circumstance, but to see them for their gifts and for the person that you want them to be in this world, thriving. And then peel back the layers of our vision so that we can see how our lives might be contributing to their suffering or their oppression. So often, oh God, we think there's nothing we can do. We feel so helpless. Empower us in this moment to not rely on that feeling as an excuse, but rather give us the courage we need to do some hard work, to examine ourselves, to see how we might both contribute to their oppression and also how we can work to eliminate it. Allow us to have a deep heart of compassion for all who suffer, no matter the cause. Even compassion for ourselves, O God, when we're the ones suffering too. Finally, Lord, we pray for eyes to see our world, our globe, our earth, as you see it. We think of the images of creation from Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, the kind of creation that is thriving, not just surviving. And so we call to mind now, O God, an aspect of your creation that we love, that we give thanks for, something in the natural world which fills our spirits and souls. Thank you for the beauty of the natural world. And even as we give thanks for that, O God, we pray that we might be the ones to work for the protection and the preservation and the conservation of your beautiful earth. May we be the stewards of the earth that you entrusted us to be. And Lord, of course, we pray for eyes to see you. To see you as the being that is beyond us, yet beside us. The spirit that is both at work around us and within us. Every time we divert our eyes from what you're trying to show us, O God, direct our eyes back again to you and to your children and to your creation and to your vision of your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and with a longing for his vision, we pray. Amen. I invite you now, as we sing this hymn with David, to really take in the words and allow this to be a continuation of our prayer time. After we sing together, we will join our voices together in praying the Lord's Prayer.
Show us how to stand for justice, how to work for what is right, how to challenge false assumptions, how to walk within the light. May we learn to share more freely in a world so full of greed, showing your immense compassion by the life we choose to lead. Teach our hearts to treasure mercy, whether given or received, for our need has not diminished since the day we first believed. Let us seek no satisfaction, boasting of what we have done, but rejoice that we are pardoned and accepted in your Son. Gladly we embrace our lifestyle modeled on your living word. In humility submitting to the truth that we have heard, make us conscious of your presence every day. Spirit's gracious prompting, may we learn to walk with you.
Yes, Lord, make us conscious of your presence every day in all we do. By your Spirit's gracious prompting, may we learn to walk with you. Even as we pray together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's gospel reading is from the 6th chapter of Luke. One Sabbath, while Jesus was going through the grain fields, his disciples plucked some heads of grain, rubbed them in their hands, and ate them. But some of the Pharisees says, "Why are you doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" Jesus answered, "Have you not read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God and took and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat, and gave some to his companions. Then he said to them, 'The Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath.' On another Sabbath he entered the synagogue and taught. There was a man there whose right hand was withered. The scribes and the Pharisees watched him to see whether he would cure on the Sabbath, so they might find an accusation against him. Even though he knew what they were thinking, he said to the man who had the withered hand, 'Come and stand here.' He got up and stood there. Then Jesus said to them, 'I ask you, is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save life or to destroy it?' After looking around at all of them, he said to him, 'Stretch out your hand.' He did so, and his hand was restored. But they were filled with fury and discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus. Now during those days he went out to the mountain to pray, and he spent the night in prayer to God. When the day came, he called his disciples and chose 12 of them, whom he also called apostles: Simon, who he named Peter, and his brother Andrew, and James and John and Philip and Bartholomew, and Matthew and Thomas, and James son of Alphaeus, and Simon who was called the Zealot, and Judas son of James, and Judas Iscariot who became a traitor. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
In our story for today, we see Jesus doing things he's not supposed to. And in both stories, whether it be the disciples eating grain in the field or the healing in the synagogue of a man's hand, the Pharisees are the bad guys in this particular story. And Jesus is causing chaos on the Sabbath, and Jesus really has been causing chaos throughout all of the scenarios up to this point. And so the Pharisees are like, okay, we've got him, especially in the healing at the synagogue because it was in front of so many people. And so we see this chance for Jesus to engage the Pharisees. And in doing so, we are reminded that the Sabbath is meant to be kept holy. But one of the holiest ways we can keep Sabbath is honoring human life before us. And so with the disciple story, where they are out in the field and they are hungry, so they just basically take the wheat and grain and they rub it and then eat it raw. And the disciples are like, whoa, that's work. And don't you know you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath? And Jesus brings up this story of David and being able to eat the sacramental bread and is like, you feed people. If they are hungry, you feed them. Sabbath or not Sabbath. And in the next story, we don't know how long time has spanned between these two particular stories, but we know that they apparently come sequentially, or at least that's how our gospel writer has written it. And so in doing this, what we see is that Jesus sees this man who has a hand that is not fully functional. We don't know what kind of deformity he may have, but he goes to the man and says, let's come up in front of everybody. And he goes to heal, and the Pharisees are like, whoa, that's not allowed, especially in the synagogue, especially on the Sabbath. What are you doing? And Jesus responds, is it not right to do good on the Sabbath? And it's not like the man was in a dire scenario where he came up to Jesus and said, I need to be healed. Jesus goes to him. And in doing so, what we can glean from this particular story is that sometimes our inaction can also be harmful. And so Jesus is saying, if you are able, why don't you? And so he heals this man's hand, and in doing so, causes a great disruption. He causes chaos once again. And it's about the Sabbath, this thing that's supposed to be restorative, kept holy for God, the thing that for the Israelites was a reminder that you do not need to produce as you did in slavery, and a reminder that rest can be a true radical act of disruption. That I will not produce for the sake of producing, I will rest and be made well. And so Jesus is doing what is considered work. And these rules were put into place so that people didn't go back into the habits or the cycles of oppression. And yet, once again, if we don't look at the heart of the law or the heart of the purpose of Sabbath, man was not made for Sabbath, but Sabbath was made for man, as we're told in Scripture. And to change out man, humanity, people, those who are made in the image of God, because God rested, so too shall we. And in doing so, we've created these rules or expectations around what Sabbath is or what counts as Sabbath. And in that process, we sometimes cling so tightly to them that we ultimately end up losing the heart of Sabbath. And Jesus reminds them, if somebody is hungry, let them eat. Even if that means you go and make them a meal. Even if it qualifies as work, you feed them. Humans and their needs matter. Again, in the story of the healing in the synagogue, we have this scenario where in action wouldn't necessarily have been evil or breaking of law or anything. It's the fact that Jesus heals on the Sabbath that breaks the law. And in doing so, the Pharisees are like, that kind of waited until the next day. Why didn't you? Why are you trying to prove a point? And yet, Christ is saying, if I have the ability, why wouldn't I? Why would I create these barriers when this can be happening and healing can take place? And then our story continues with the naming of the emissaries, the missionaries, the disciples. And when I first read it, I thought it was a very weird way to end this particular part of the narrative lectionary for this Sunday. Why would you go through the naming of the disciples? But in previous weeks, we've been seeing their call stories. Where are they coming from? How did they get into this work? And now we are naming them and saying, you shall go out and do. And so for us here today, I think being able to say our names follow Judas's in that long lineage of disciples who seek to follow the ways and teachings of Jesus. So what does that look like for us? Our Sabbath looks so very different than it did a year ago. We are not in the sanctuary, and while I am today, we are not joined together. We have not regularly been in the space that helps us capture spaces of ritual and meaning and worship. And so being able to acknowledge that we, in our own rulemaking, that shouldn't be worn in the sanctuary, or this person is causing a disruption that shouldn't happen during worship, or why can't we just keep the music the way it's always been? Why do we have to change it? Or why can't we change it? Why are we stuck in a certain way? Or that's my pew. You're in my pew. How am I supposed to worship? And I don't say these things to make fun of, but to acknowledge that we create unspoken rules around how we observe Sabbath, especially when we are in our sanctuary. Not because we want to be rigid, not because we want to be somebody who says this is the only way. We don't want to be Pharisees. It happens because we are people who want to be able to connect to God, and when something comes in to even disrupt that ever so slightly, it can cause us a struggle to figure out, well, what comes next? How do I worship? How do I engage? How do I not get distracted? And so through all of that, we sometimes create these rules around Sabbath. You're not supposed to do that. You're not supposed to have practice on Sunday. You're not supposed to go to games on Sunday. You're not supposed to drink on Sunday. You're not supposed to do these things on Sunday. Why can't we have nice dress in worship on Sunday? Why do we now have relaxed dress on Sunday? These are questions that matter to us for whatever reason. And it's a complexity around how we make meaning and how we understand our spaces with God. So again, while we look at this text and give a hard time to the Pharisees, I think we actually have more in common with them than we realize. For you see, they did not realize they were not honoring the Sabbath. They thought that's exactly what they were doing. And Jesus was the one disrupting it. And they were the ones to say to Jesus, don't do it. helping you stay in line with the law. That's not a bad thing. That's not something that is considered poor teaching. It's what the Pharisees did. They taught, they educated, and they brought people into the ways of being. In our moments where we create these unspoken expectations or these unspoken rules, and sometimes we just name them and they are very spoken and known, we limit our ability to see that the Sabbath was made for us, not us for it. Meaning that if the Sabbath is truly created for us, then our human well-being, which it was created for, so out of slavery, they needed rest. They needed to be told that they didn't need to produce to have value. These people needed to be able to be reminded that it's okay to take a break, to connect with God and to worship and restore our weary souls. And so from that, we're able to actually see that there is a chance for us to remember that any time human dignity is presented before us and we choose to say that doesn't belong in worship or that doesn't belong here, we can talk about it in a small group, but not in public spaces like a sermon or in spaces that disrupt things. It can be in an interest group so that those who are interested are able to engage, but not here. When we do those types of things, we think we are creating peace. We think we are creating harmony. We think we're allowing all to be seen and all to be felt and heard. And yet, as I'm reminded of Amanda Gorman's beautiful poem, silence does not mean peace. The Pharisees were wanting Jesus to be silent so that peace in the synagogue and their practices could continue, and yet he caused chaos on the Sabbath. Teaching us that humanity's needs, when there is something we can do to heal, when there's something we can do to help feed, when there is a chance to see that the person in front of us needs us, and maybe it's not an individual person, but maybe it's a group of people, whomever needs healing, whomever needs to feel seen and beloved by God, whoever is oppressed, come to God with your heavy burdens, and he will give you peace. He will give you rest. He will be the one to say that no religious rule shall ever overcome the call to love our neighbors as ourselves. And so, what does this mean for us? And how do we engage it? And how are we able to live this out? Being able to realize that sometimes naming things is important. Jesus did not have to heal the man in the synagogue and yet did. And sometimes it means we have to name things that would otherwise be possible in other spaces. Not because we wish to stir the pot, not because we wish to cause chaos, but because the gospel is too good not to proclaim. That the gospel that you are beloved, that all shall be able to be fed and taken care of, that those who have been left by society have not been left by the church. That we get to be our full selves in front of God and say, here I am, and God says, I see you. What do you need? Christ was not about comforting the comfortable. Christ was always about ensuring that those who've been left out, those who've been told to be silent and be still and find your place or do it respectfully or not that way, but you can do it this way when you advocate for yourself. Christ was the one to say, come to me and I will help you. There is no rule greater than your well-being. There is no rule greater than the fact that we are called to love one another. And sometimes, friends, living into that means that we are going to be made uncomfortable. But it's really, really important to remember that our discomfort is not oppression, that our discomfort is not victimization. Our discomfort is an aspect of our growth. It doesn't mean we aren't mindful. It doesn't mean we don't do it gently and lovingly. It doesn't mean that we just go about naming what is wrong in the world without options of action or redemption. It doesn't mean we cause harm in doing this. The Pharisees were not harmed by the healing of the man's hand, and yet they were made uncomfortable. Sometimes our discomfort can feel like chaos. And we want to stop chaos because our world feels so chaotic that if we have one more aspect of chaos, we're going to scream. And so we say, not here, because I need this to be okay. And yet, what we realize is that when we do that, we become Pharisees ourselves. I have rules of how I like to worship. I am such a high church nerd. Give me the incense and the bells and the smells and have me hear a cantor, and I am so at church. And yeah, if I say that is the only way we can worship, that is the only way to experience God, I have become a Pharisee. When we met in the sanctuary and somebody would come in who needed help, I often have to admit that I would often say, well, not right now, because I have to go and do my job. I have been a Pharisee. I need the gift of being invited back into this work. I need friends like you to help me remember that Sabbath was made for man and not the other way around. That in this, I too need to be liberated. I too need to be cared for. And I too need to see how those rules harm my own human dignity. How they keep me from loving my neighbor, and in not being able to love my neighbor, I can't fully love myself or understand what God has called me to. So, let us free the Sabbath. Not because it needs to be free, but we need to freely experience the Sabbath. May people be healed. May people be fed. May people be sheltered and cared for. And may we see the challenges like we saw in Peter and going out into the deep waters like Pastor Ann talked about last week. May we realize that even in the chaotic waters that feel so tumultuous, that we are too called there, and in that space, Sabbath can happen. Sabbath is not different than the chaos of the world. It is the fact that we live in Sabbath and engage the chaos. If it is the other way around, we will continually run into protecting the Sabbath with rules. So may Sabbath be how we live and bring in work into that space instead of the other way around, so that we can find ways to continue to liberate ourselves through redemption and through God's grace. May we too add our names to the emissaries who are listed at the end of this story. You, dear ones, carry on that legacy. And in carrying it on, we have the chance to remind one another that chaos on the Sabbath does not mean dishonoring the Sabbath. Sometimes our ways of being need to be disrupted. We've learned that in ways we can't even imagine from this past year, and yet we've made it through. We can do hard things, dear, dear ones. So let us go forth and figure out how we can honor the Sabbath by honoring the humanity that is before us. And when we get discomforted, when we get uncomfortable, may we lean into the Spirit that says, I've got you. Let's take the next step. Go, dear ones, and be the ones who cause chaos on the Sabbath for the sake of the good news, and always because you are loving your neighbor. Amen.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come. All praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son. And all praise to the Spirit, who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
My brothers and sisters and siblings in the Spirit, I pray that wherever you are worshiping today, you are able to connect to the Spirit of God in such a way that you can go forth in that long line of disciples that says, we have this work, we can carry it forward. Reminding one another that the Sabbath is made for us and not the other way around. May you know that loving our neighbors is the greatest call we've been given. May we go forth and live it well. Amen.
Thank you.
maybe somewhere down the road when somebody plays the purple haze.
Well, it's all right, even when push comes to shove.
I'm just glad to be here, happy to feel that. And it don't matter if you're by my side.
Seek no satisfaction in a world so full of... Oh, are you kidding me?
Okay, I want to do it one more time. Test, test, test. Take. This is the real take. Test, test, test. I invite you now as we sing this... Ah.